Good morning, panelists, and good morning, audience. That was good presentation by Dr. Mithilesh. The topic which was given to me is pathophysiology of cardiogenic shock. I'm Dr. Sridhar, cardiologist from Medicover Hospital. So basically, I'm trying to speak about Dr. Sharon said, cardiology perspective of cardiogenic shock. So before that, I would like to give a brief introduction. So as it is already defined, cardiogenic shock is defined as marked hypotension, which is primarily due to myocardial pump performance, reduced myocardial pump performance. Either it is due to myocardial dysfunction or some outflow obstruction, which results in severe tissue hyperperfusion and multi-organ dysfunction in the absence of any hypovolemia or shock. So despite many advances, including the advent of mechanical circulatory devices, the mortality seems to be very high, ranging from 50 to 80%, 50% in whom the intervention has, no intervention has been applied to, in 80% in whom no intervention has applied to 50% in whom some kind of intervention has been applied, particularly primary PCI. And this cardiogenic shock continues to be a leading cause of in-hospital death in patients with post-MI. The key is to detect early, predict the patients who will subsequently land up in cardiogenic shock, and start the various measures upfront. These things can reduce the mortality in cardiogenic shock. So as I said, the ACS situation, ischemic heart disease, particularly ACS, is most common cause of cardiogenic shock. The in vivo studies have shown that it requires more than 40% loss of ventricular muscle, including stunned but viable myocardium, to produce the cardiogenic shock. Of course, in patients with underlying LV dysfunction, a small loss of myocardial function can also result in cardiogenic shock. Historically, the incidence of shock in MI is 7 to 10%. And as I said, the mortality ranges from 50% to 80%. The incidence is highest in males. The overall incidence is highest in males, but the percentage of patients with MI who develop cardiogenic shock is more in females, maybe because of late presentation and less aggressive management. The median time of occurrence is 6.2 hours, but it can occur early, particularly in the setting of ACS due to LMCA or LMCA equivalents. There is one study which showed that the patients who develop shock early have good prognosis than later patients. This is particularly common with the STEMI patients who present dramatically and result and occupy more attention, leading to various interventions which will improve the prognosis. Generally, non-STEMI have a wait and watch approaches, leading to delayed revascularizations and subsequently patients land up in shocks. So etiology has been already described, but you can notice that the major chunk of etiology is due to ischemic heart disease, particularly ACS situation. And then there are other causes like cardiomyopathy, myocarditis, or valvular heart disease, but mechanical reasons secondary to valvular heart diseases, PTE, obstructive hypertrophic cardiomyopathies, and lastly, arrhythmias can also lead to cardiogenic shock. So how common? As we know, the cardiogenic shock generally goes with LV dysfunction, but the RV ventricle is also commonly involved. So RV infarction with shock occurs in 10% of the inferior wall MI patients. Also, if you look in patients with LV dysfunction also, LV dysfunction generally leads to increased LV end diastolic pressures, which translate into increased pulmonary artery diastolic pressures, which is afterload to the right ventricle. Right ventricle being very thin, it is less adaptive to the afterloads. So frequently it lands up in RV dysfunctions. So more commonly in a subset of patient in a spectrum of cardiogenic shock, it is biventricular shock more often than the left ventricular dominant shock. So this gave rise to the concept of RV supports or RV mechanical circulatory device supports. So the important slide in my presentation, the pathophysiology. So what happens when a patient has acute coronary syndrome, particularly acute ST elevation myocardial infarction? Generally, myocardial infarction leads to both systolic as well as diastolic dysfunction. In fact, from our studies, from our MDDM studies, diastolic dysfunction has earlier onset than systolic dysfunction. So whenever a patient has an MI, the occlusion of coronary artery results in myocardial dysfunction of that part of the muscle supplied by that vessel. So leading to the poor contractility. If that area is more than 40%, it leads to myocardial dysfunction and reduced ejection fraction. That is, it results in reduced cardiac output and stroke volume. This reduced cardiac output leads to hypotension, that is less than 90 mm of Hg, or mean arterial pressure less than 60. This in turn reduces the coronary perfusion. So as you know, the myocardium is already under ischemia. So this reduced coronary perfusion further increases ischemia, throws the patient into a spiral, ischemia spiral. Not only when the cardiac output is reduced, the peripheral perfusion is reduced, which stimulates our physiological sympathetic system, which results in increased sympathetic drive, tachycardia, peripheral vasoconstriction, and some amount of fluid retention. These try to compensate the loss of BP and improve the blood pressures. But later on, they tend to become counterproductive because any increase in LV end diastolic pressures further increases the wall stress and it increases the ischemia. So again, this ischemia, reduced cardiac output, and physiological response, these things, they perpetuate and they lead to progressive LV dysfunction. And finally, the cardiogenic shock leads to death. Recent studies have shown that the myocardial infarction is, large myocardial infarction is not just about LV dysfunction, but also invokes systemic inflammatory response kind of situation, where in patients with large MI, there is usually increased inflammatory markers such as raised WBC counts, raised interleukins, raised CRPs. These, they peripherally, they stimulate release of inflammatory nitric oxide, which in turn releases nitric oxide. Nitric oxide stimulates release of interleukins. They peripherally act and cause peripheral vasodilatation. So they reduces the venous in input. So they also reduces the sensitivity of the receptors to the catecholamines. The nitric oxide also has negative inotropic effect on the and on the myocardium. So these effects progressively they lead to the myocardial dysfunction and death. So how diastolic dysfunction increases ischemia is, once there is a diastolic dysfunction, the LV end diastolic pressures increase, which is transmitted to lung and it results in pulmonary edema. It impairs oxygen transfer, results in hypoxia and further ischemia. So this slide tells about what happens when there is a ischemia in the multivessel diseases. So when you have a multivessel disease, an infarction at one side leads to myocardial dysfunction at that particular site. So in order to compensate, there is hyperkinesis in the rest of the myocardium. But if that myocardium is supplied by the diseased coronary arteries, there is a reduced perfusion. It results in ischemia at a distance. So it leads to pump failure and hypotension and irreversible cardiogenic shock. So this slide has been already shown. So I just want to emphasize that it is important to identify the patient early, the patients who are at risk of developing cardiogenic shock. That patients who have a large acute antral MI or has multivessel disease, these are the patients who are at risk of developing cardiogenic shock subsequently. So these patients should be carefully monitored, careful physical examination, as well as assessment of biochemical markers. And sometimes, if needed, the patient needs to undergo hemodynamic assessment, invasive hemodynamic assessment, to determine if the patient might go into cardiogenic shock so that the treatment can be started early. So as the panelists have said, the history physical examination is key in identifying patients who are at risk of cardiogenic shock. So patients with history of risk factors presenting with chest pain more likely to have ischemic heart disease, and physical examination needs to be performed on a regular basis to assess the signs, early signs of tissue hypoperfusion. Of course, the biochemical lab findings, they help in identifying patients like increased acidosis, increased lactates. They help in identifying patients who are going into cardiogenic shock. So of interest is invasive hemodynamic monitoring. So any patient with shock with a hypotension of 90 mmHg, in order to be labeled as cardiogenic shock, it requires to prove that there is some issue with the myocardial function. So the investigations which needs to be performed to document myocardial dysfunction is 2D echocardiogram, so which helps in regular assessment of myocardial functions, either at the baseline or progressive deterioration. It also helps in identifying mechanical complications such as ventricular septal. Any patients who was stable otherwise, subsequently if develops cardiogenic shock, there could be a possibility of mechanical complications like ventricular septal rupture, papillary dysfunction with severe MR, or sometimes patient can have a large pericardial effusion. So invasive blood pressure monitoring is helpful for accurate assessment of blood pressure. That will be described and discussed by another speaker. The pulmonary artery catheterization. So of late, there has been studies that using pulmonary artery catheterization for hemodynamic assessment of patients at risk of shock helps in improving the mortality of the patients. This pulmonary artery catheterization is key to assess various hemodynamic parameters like pulmonary artery pressures, pulmonary artery capillary wedge pressures, cardiac output, cardiac index, and so on. So this invasive hemodynamic assessment helps us to classify patients into various subgroups like cold, wet, cold, dry. So there is often interchange between these subset of classifications, because a patient with classic cardiogenic shock, if intervened early by primary PCI, can become a normal person. So the hemodynamic assessment usually helps us in identifying the patients, putting them into different subsets, and tailoring the therapies. Another thing is hemodynamic assessment helps in plotting the pressure volume loops. So pressure volume loops have become very important in assessing the intrinsic myocardial dysfunction and the state of preload and afterload conditions. On my left, you can see, the Frank Starling curve plotted against stroke volume and end diastolic pressure. The first dark black line is a normal curve that indicates that as and when the left ventricular end diastolic pressure increases, the stroke volume increases. In the setting of intrinsic loss of myocardial function, this curve is shifted to right and below. So the major working point of Frank Starling curve shifts to right and below. So that indicates that so there is an increased left ventricular end diastolic pressure, which in turn translates into increased myocardial oxygen demand. On my right side, the pressure volume loops loop diagram is there, so which plots pressure volume curve. In a normal patient, the ESPUR, so end systolic pressure volume relationship is very steep, indicating that end systolic pressures are very less and end diastolic volumes are very less. In patients with severe LV dysfunction, this ESPVR curve shifts to right and below, indicating that end systolic volume is very less. So, though there is compensatory increase in end diastolic volume, it is not as expected as reduction in the end systolic volume. So, this results in a lesser area, that means a lesser stroke volume. Lesser stroke volume with the increased end systolic volumes results in reduced ejection fraction. So, knowing hemodynamic status, the first, so I'll just try to describe what are the various effects of our interventions on pathophysiology of cardiogenic shock. The first intervention generally started in any patient with cardiogenic shock is inotropes or vasopressors. So once started, what happens? So in patients with cardiogenic shock who are started on vasopressors, the ESPVR generally shifts to right, shifts to the left. That means there is increase in arterial stiff impedance, that is arterial resistance, so the ESPVR shifts to the left. So that results in decreased or normal stroke volume, but increased arterial resistance. So this results in increased myocardial oxygen demand. So if you just look at the plot area under this PV loop, the area increases in comparison to normal. The area increases. That means there is an increasing myocardial oxygen demand in already failing heart. In patients who are started on inotrope, this ESPER is shifted to right and below. So as inotropes, they increase the cardiac contractility, the end systolic volume decreases. End systolic volume decreases and it results in increased stroke volume. So as you have seen, so both of the vasopressors and inotropes, they try to maintain the blood pressure by shifting the loops to the left, but they increase the myocardial oxygen demands, so which is deleterious to already failing heart. So if you look at a normal heart and a failing heart, the failing heart tends to progressively dilate. So these, the rate, as you know from the Laplace law, the myocardial oxygen consumption is inversely proportional to the radius. As the radius increases, directly proportional. As the radius increases, myocardial oxygen demand increases. So you need a mechanical support that unloads the heart, reduces the diameter or end diastolic volume as well as end diastolic pressures in left ventricle. So that it decreases the myocardial oxygen demand as well as it improves the cardiac outputs. So important of the device is impella. So here this exactly same thing happens. Impella, it transfers blood from the LV into the aorta. So it increases the cardiac output, results in increased outflow, increased mean arterial pressure, so that increases the tissue perfusion and reduces the inflammatory markers. As well, because it unloads the heart, so the LVDPL, left ventricular end diastolic pressure, also reduces, which ultimately translates into reduced wall tension and reduced myocardial oxygen demand. Also, when there is a reduced wall tension, it reduces the microvascular resistance and improves the myocardial perfusion and ultimately oxygen supply. Because the wall tension is decreased, the oxygen demand of the myocardium is also reduced. So as it results in unloading of the heart and reduced mechanical work. It also generates some cardioprotective signals, ultimately leads to some positive remodeling of the LV. So these are the various loops. The understanding of loops become very important with the advent of new mechanical circulatory devices. So these are the various loops in various devices. The upper left is pressure PV loop in patients with cardiogenic shock in whom IABP has been placed. As you can see, the loop has been shifted left and downwards. That results in reduced myocardial work or stroke work. So which ultimately improves the myocardial oxygen, myocardial performance. In patients with who are placed on the impeller, so the same loop is shifted left and right, left and down, but it becomes triangular because of the blunted isovolumic contraction and relaxation phases. Because there is an impeller in place across the myocardial valve, so and there is a continuous pumping of blood into the aorta, the isovolumic contraction phases are blunted. So this results in a small triangular loop, but still the loop is shifted on the beneficial side and the myocardial oxygen demand is reduced. In contrast to the impeller, so when you use ECMO, which transfers blood from venous into the artery, the aortic pressures or aortic impedance is increased, which results in shifting of the ESPVR to down. That means end systolic pressure or volume increases. So which ultimately increases the myocardial oxygen demand, and it also results in adverse cardiac remodeling and leads to RV dysfunction also. So in order to obviate this effect, so there is a newer device called ECPella. So wherein the impeller reduces the, improves the cardiac output by unloading the heart, whereas ECMO improves the tissue perfusion. So all these devices, they help in reducing the, help in unloading the heart and reducing the myocardial oxygen demand and reducing the risk of cardiogenic shock. So to conclude, so there is better understanding of pathophysiology of cardiogenic shock, usually by hemodynamic assessment, particularly pulmonary artery catheter, it guides subsequent therapeutic strategies and may improve the outcome of cardiogenic shock. Thank you.